Hi, everyone. I'm going to present a talk titled Server Tailgating, a Chosen Plaintext Attack on RDP. I'm Yaron from the Preempt Research Labs, and Preempt is a security firm focused around identity and authentication. And our previous work dealt with finding vulnerabilities on LDAP-S and on Azure AD Connect. I'm Yaron, I'm going to present the first part. It's the introduction and the technical background. Then Eyal is going to present the vulnerability details, and Roman would sum up the talk. So what we're going to see, we're going to show you a cryptographic vulnerability. It's a logical vulnerability, and we find it interesting as the exploitation is rather unique. It's not your standard buffer overflow. It has a unique type of exploitation that we've managed to accomplish. It has an high impact. This means that if your network has an Active Directory in place and you are using RDP, remote, which is the most popular remote desktop application, then you are probably vulnerable to this issue. And as we'll explain later, it is not fully patched. This means that even now, as Microsoft patched the issue, it is still a huge issue in networks. So just so we'll have a wider context, if we're discussing targeted attacks have many phases. There's the initial infection phase, the reconnaissance phase, there's obviously the exploitation or exfiltration phase, and a phase that we find interesting is the lateral movement phase. In the lateral movement phase, the attacker has some foothold in our network, and he wishes to expand his foothold. He wishes to take advantage of the machine he's already infected and find other machines to infect. These machines, it could be to harvest credentials, it could be to find high valuable assets, and we think that the vulnerability we found is especially suited for lateral movement. So the first thing I want to do is I want to present a small technical background. Some of you might already be familiar with the protocols that we're going to present, but I did want to have a common baseline for all the listeners so everyone could understand the deep vulnerability details. The first protocol that I'm going to talk about is Kerberos. Kerberos is an open protocol. It was developed by MIT, and it was adapted by Microsoft as the default authentication protocol from a while back. Starting Windows 2000, Kerberos is the default authentication protocol. And the way that it works is there's a central entity in the MIT protocol, it's called the KDC. In a Microsoft environment, it's the domain controller. And the domain controller holds all the secrets for your network. It holds the user's passwords, and it also holds the machine passwords. And when a user wants to log in, he presents his password to his machine, and he creates a special ticket. The ticket is called a TGT, the ticket granting ticket. And it does that with a request, with a message called an AS request, and he receives the TGT in an AS reply. And then he could use the TGT to create TGS tickets. These are the ticket granting servers. It's created with a message that is called the TGS request, and you receive the TGS via the TGS reply. And then the user can present the TGS to a server that he wants to connect with, perhaps a file server, and the server would authenticate him. Now, the key issue here is that the TGS is encrypted with the server's password. This means that any relay attack or man in the middle would only be exploitable on this specific server, and the TGS ticket cannot be used in any other server. The second protocol that I'm going to mention is the MSRPC protocol. MSRPC is also an adaptation by Microsoft for an open protocol, the DCE-RPC protocol. And it is used to administer and configure a Windows machine in the networks, in the network. And it is a popular protocol for IT administration tools. You probably know about PSExec and WMI. All these protocols are using MSRPC. And the way that MSRPC works is that every process on the remote machine exposes an interface, and the interface is exposed via MSRPC, and in the interface there are several procedures that a remote machine can run on the machine via MSRPC. Now I'm going to discuss SSPI. SSPI is something most application developers are not aware of. It's an adaptation of also an open standard, the GSS API. And the SSPI is an interface applications use to have security in their application. In fact, when an application says that it supports Windows authentication, usually it means that it implements some sort of SSPI interface. And the SSPI has two responsibilities. The first is the negotiation. In the negotiation phase, the SSPI negotiates the authentication protocol we're going to use and the encryption algorithm that we're going to use. After the negotiation phase, each time the applications want to send a packet securely to another server, it sends the packet first to the SSPI. SSPI makes sure the packet is encrypted and signed and forwarded into the network. There are several interesting SSPIs. There are the Kerberos SSPI, the NTLM SSPI, and also a negotiate SSPI that is able to automatically choose between the two. The next protocol that I'm going to discuss is TLS. I'm sure you've all heard of TLS. TLS is the de facto encryption standard for the internet. It is used in HTTPS. It is used in voice over IP. It is also used in RDP, which is our focus for the talk today. This is why it's interesting. TLS usually revolves around RSA. This means that the server has a certificate, and each time a client wants to connect to the server, the server sends its certificate, and the certificate is being used by the client for secure key exchange. Now I'm going to discuss CRED SSP. CRED SSP is a bit more obscure. It is a protocol that is not open. It was developed by Microsoft. And the purpose of this protocol is to enable two machines to securely forward credentials. Usually, as I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, when a client wants to connect to a server, it doesn't send its password. It either sends a TGS in the case for Kerberos, or it sends a challenge response in the NTLM case, but the password doesn't go over the network at all. But with RDP, it's different. With RDP, you would like to send your password to the remote machine for an interactive login. And Microsoft realized that when you want to send plain text credentials, you want additional security. So CRED SSP provides this additional security. It provides mutual authentication. It provides double encryption via first TLS and secondly the network level authentication that is provided by the GSS API. And it has a special technique that is referred to as channel binding. And with channel binding, you're meant to block several types of man-in-the-middle attacks that can take place. So how does the protocol work? As we can see here, first the user creates a TLS session. Over the TLS session, the protocol is being negotiated. It can be Kerberos or NTLM, and a session key for the network level authentication is created. Then, in order to block man-in-the-middle attacks, the client takes some derivative of the server certificate and signs it with the session key it obtained via Kerberos. Now, this essentially assures to both the client and the server that they are both acting in the same TLS session and no man-in-the-middle decrypted and initiated a new TLS session. The final protocol that I'm going to mention is RDP. RDP is the protocol for Microsoft Remote Desktop. Microsoft Remote Desktop has several modes of security. It has the full mode of security. In the full mode, essentially RDP uses CRED SSP, the protocol I previously mentioned. And there's also a mode where RDP works with TLS alone or with no security at all. And another interesting security feature in RDP we wanted to mention is RDP restricted admin. And RDP restricted admin mode is a mode that was created by Microsoft for the following use case. Sometimes you want to connect to a remote machine and you don't fully trust the machine. Perhaps you suspect machine is already compromised. And obviously, if you would forward your plain text password to the infected machine, your password is going to be compromised. So for this purpose, Microsoft created the restricted admin mode. In restricted admin, you only perform network login and you never forward your credentials. And probably for code reuse reasons, restricted admin still uses CRED SSP and not regular authentication. And RDP flow, just to sum up, is like that. When a client wants to connect to a server, he creates a TLS session. He creates a network level authentication with CRED SSP. Then in some cases, the server certificate is going to be validated. And after the certificate is validated, the client would send his password over the secure channel and the session would be established. And once we review this flow, it got us thinking. Because usually, if you are familiar with TLS, the first thing you would want to do is you would want to validate the server certificate. If you don't validate the server certificate, there are all sorts of security risks that you are facing. And we saw that Microsoft chose to first do the network level authentication and only then validate the certificate. And we actually discussed this issue with Microsoft, and Microsoft told us the reason. The reason is that Microsoft wants to avoid warning fatigue, or alert fatigue, if you will, and they chose not to present a certificate warning when the chosen protocol is Kerberos. And the reason is the reason I mentioned before. When you have a TGS, the TGS is directed on a particular server, and the risk for a man in the middle is significantly lower. You can't trust that only you are the one that is in control of the, over the RDP session. With NTLM, this is not the case. And if there's no public key infrastructure in your network and the certificate is self-signed and is not trusted, a warning would appear. In this case, the warning is going to be a rather unique event in the network, and the user can suspect when he sees a warning that something is not usual. So I'll recap all the protocols that we've mentioned. We've mentioned RDP. RDP uses the security layers from TLS and CRED SSP. We also mentioned MSRPC, and both RDP and MSRPC will select either Kerberos or NTLM as their authentication protocols. So thanks for bearing with me this far. Now I'm going to hand over the stage to Eyal. He's going to present the really interesting part, which is the vulnerability itself.
Okay, thank you, Yaron, for this interesting introduction and technical background. I will present our journey toward the vulnerability. It began in a previous vulnerability. In that vulnerability, we researched NTLM relay. We wanted to do NTLM relay in the context of RDP. NTLM relay is obviously possible if you control the server the user connects to. You simply relay the negotiation to another server. But we could also do NTLM relay in RDP if we don't have control over the server, but just from a man-in-the-middle position. This is possible exactly from the reason Yaron mentioned earlier. The NLA process is done before the certificate validation. So during the NLA process, NTLM is taking place and we can relay the negotiation to another server. This made us interesting. We began researching RDP, looking for more issues. So then I examined the specifications of CRED SSP. CRED SSP, as Yaron mentioned, is the protocol that is responsible for authentication in RDP. And I came across this paragraph. So what it says, actually, that in the final negotiation message, the client sends alongside the public key, alongside the final negotiation message, it also sends the public key of the given by the server, which is encrypted and signed using SSPI, as any client application would. So you can see that the server sends the public key, and afterwards the client signs it. This is actually a classic scenario for choosing plain text attack, because the client signs on bytes of given by the server that are really unverified, unvalidated. And so it signs, it is signed as if it were an application data. But could it be really a valid application data of another protocol? We will see that it can be. So here it works. We have a client that wishes to connect to a server. We also have an attacker that is a man in the middle. When the client does RDP session initiation, the attacker intercepts it and send a rogue certificate. This rogue certificate is actually a malicious payload, but also a valid public key. Then there's Kerberos negotiation. This Kerberos negotiation would be relayed via a chosen protocol to a server. And afterwards, in the final negotiation message, the client sends the malicious payload, which is the public key, which is both signed and encrypted, and the attacker simply relays it to the server. Ironically, the same protocol that is used to protect against man-in-the-middle attack, that is CRED SSP, it actually allows us to carry out a man-in-the-middle attack. But we have some obstacles to overcome because the malicious data should still be valid in the TLS session. It actually should be valid as a RSA key, and that is not necessarily trivial. Let's see how it can be accomplished. Now, we'll review a bit RSA. So RSA is a private case of asymmetrical encryption. In asymmetrical encryption, you have the public key. In this case, it is N and E. And the private key, which is D, and everyone can encrypt data using the public key, which is known to all. But only the server holds the private key. So I'm sure most of you are familiar with it, but let's go deeper a bit. So how it is implemented mathematically, in RSA, N part of the public key is actually a product of two primes, and we have that E, which is the public exponent, is the inverse modulus of D, which is the private key. And this is how encryption works. From theorems known from number theorem, we know that it works. But this structure makes it hard for us to control the public key. We want it to be also a malicious data. So we have chosen to implement a different variant of RSA, which we call a broken RSA. Of course, RSA is not really a broken, it's just a name. And in this case, we choose N to be a single prime number. And from the same mathematics, everything else remains almost the same. And from the same mathematical reasons, it still works. I mean, it is still a valid encryption, but I don't suggest you to use it at home. It is really easily breakable. Okay, so now N is a prime number. But does it really help us? Apparently it is, because given a random 600 bytes of data, which let's say it's a payload, we have a relatively high chance of it being a prime. About 1 in 3,000 random bytes are actually a prime. So what we do is the following. We fix the wanted payload and we concat to it additional 2 bytes. We brute force these additional bytes until the entire n part is a prime. And so, and in this way, we can find a prime, and it takes us not that long amount of time to find such a prime. So the first obstacle is passed, and we have now a working encryption. But there are other restrictions to compare to concern. We have to remember the way it is encoded. So actually, in the final negotiation message, the client sends both N and E, but in the following structure. And we know we have full control, almost full control over N, and we have full control over E, but we don't have almost any control over the first 8 bytes. Because they are a TLV, tag length value. And so we need to overcome this. Okay, let's sum up the requirements. We need to find a protocol that supports Windows authentication. Almost any Windows standard protocol does that. We also have to fulfill a certain encoding requirements, and we need to be able to do harm with a single signed packet, as it is all what is given to us by the client, just a single packet. And it took some time, but finally we found a right protocol, which is MSRDP. MSRPC, sorry. And MSRPC really satisfies all the conditions. And okay, so at this point I got excited. I really started to coding and implementing this, but it didn't work. After some time, I figured out what happened. We did try to exploit it in NTLM context, and in NTLM, in SSPI, the part that is being signed is the entire packet, but the part that is encrypted is only the application data. The application data is the SSPI part, actually. But this is inconsistent with the way the public key structure we saw earlier is treated. This is because the entire public key structure is both signed and encrypted. So it seems that we have another requirement, which is to find a protocol with no header. And now finding such protocol would produce a stronger exploit, because it would be able us to relay the NTLM to another server, where in case of Kerberos, we can only relate to the same server the client want to connect to. The RPC still works in Kerberos because, as you can see, the only part that is both signed and encrypted is the public is the application data, and this is consistent with the way the public key is treated. So, from in this perspective, NTLM is actually a bit better than Kerberos, but of course I don't suggest to use NTLM, as in general it is much less secure. Okay, so now we have most of the details done. I mean, what we need to do is to choose an interface to implement it. Now, because the way RPC is coded, if there's a string in the function that is called, then some bytes are ignored. And so we choose a function which the first argument of it is string. The procedure that we chose is a schedule task registration command, and it is registered for a... Okay, and what we do in the exploit, you could do other things. We put a payload in a share, and we register a task that would cause it to run using the user of system, assuming the user as a local admin on the target server. And this is how it's done. So everything works. And let's see how it works in the demo. Okay. So what we have here is we have the environment. We have above the domain controller. This is actually locked. I hope it doesn't cause problem. Okay, so we have above the domain controller and we have below the client, and the client wishes to connect to the domain controller. And what is going to happen is in the middle, there's also in the right side two windows of the man in the middle. And okay, so what I'm going to do is first of all create a payload, which the payload would be a standard reverse shell. And then I'm going to generate... Oh, sorry. Not right. What I'm going to do now is I'm going... Ah, okay, it was right. Okay. So I'm going to generate a suitable command. That means to generate a certificate that would work. And and of course, by the way, we could choose any payload. We just chose the reverse shell as a demonstration. And what we need to do now is first to wait for the reverse shell to connect us. And secondly, we have the attack script. And the attack script actually wait for the man in the middle. Well, let's hope it works. So now the client wishes to connect to the domain controller, and it actually... Okay, so what happens now is that the client connects, the session is getting intercepted, and as we can see, we already have a reverse shell on the DC, and there's actually almost no indication. We could see that the only indication that the client will receive is this standard disconnect message. And we can see that we are a system, and we can run a calc just for fun on the domain controller, but if we were a real attacker, then what we would do is we would dump all the hashes. Sorry, this is probably wrong. Ah, okay. So, a success, we have a full domain compromise here, and there was, as you can see, no suspicious indication. So, thank you. Now, Roman will sum up and say its conclusion.
Eyal, what do I do? Perfect. Thank you, Eyal, for the fascinating technical details of this vulnerability. I don't think there is much more I can say technically, because that was everything we had. I do hope you enjoyed the journey that we presented, because it took us some time to create this kind of an exploit, and also to convince Microsoft that it was an issue. So you probably ask yourselves, should you care about what we just presented? We do find that, you know, Windows, Active Directory, and RDP are things that are commonly used by everyone, and this vulnerability is relevant to every Windows version ever released. We did choose to exploit the vulnerability using a man-in-the-middle technique, but it is also important to mention that those are relevant today, and it is a common practice for attackers to laterally move in the network. On some hardened networks, it might be difficult to target the domain controller, and if techniques like pass the hash would fail, you could see something like that being used. It is a way to get a domain controller and a domain compromise easily. So, as I mentioned, the vulnerability itself affects all Windows versions. We chose to target RDP, while in fact we know that other applications and services are also vulnerable to this technique. Things like WinRM, that is used for PowerShell remoting, is also vulnerable in the same way. And if you're using other RDP implementations, they are also affected. And they will need a patch to continue working after what I'm about to say. So, what we did is we contacted Microsoft MSRC with our findings, and I'm going to discuss that in detail. So the first thing that was reported is the issue, the number one issue that was presented here by Yaron, is the fact that NLA, the network level authentication, is something that happens before the certificate of the server is validated. Now, as Yaron explained, it's a by design thing, and it's true that NLA takes proceeding over certificate trust validation. Microsoft does recommend using a remote credential guard to mitigate this issue, and when I'm saying remote credential guard, that prevents NTLM relay using NLA. So that's regarding the minor issue that was presented here. But the second and more interesting issue is the malicious certificate. That's what Eyal has demonstrated. So Microsoft did confirm this to be a vulnerability. And last week, they've released a patch. This is a link to their guidelines on how things should be handled. They did introduce, as part of the CRED SSP protocol, which was the one affected by this vulnerability, a new version, versions 5 and 6, and those versions mitigate the vulnerability. What they did was to modify the protocol so that instead of the client signing the public key itself. It signs the public key hash, and that kind of addresses the flaw. Now, it is important to say that it's not something that Yaron mentioned, that it's not fully patched, and I'm going to address that. So what they released last week is a patch that allows you to configure the system differently and prevent from the vulnerability being exploited, but this does require a GPO configuration to take place. You probably ask yourselves why they did that. So I'll do a quick wrap up of how the disclosure timeline looked like. We've reported them the vulnerability somewhere in August last year, and they have requested some time to deal with this vulnerability. And the reason for that was related to the fact that Credit SSP or implementations that use Credit SSP are very common, and the patch required changing the protocol. So it took them some time to, you know, figure out what's the best way to do that and how to prevent from business from breaking. So what they did last week was to release a patch that allows you to reconfigure your settings to prevent from the vulnerability to affect your network. But this does require a GPO change. What will happen in May, tentatively, is a second patch that will restrict the use of previous versions by default, and that way you all will be fully patched. It is important to say for the CISOs here that there are like two critical months when this thing is still out there, and if you didn't do any configuration change using the GPO settings they provide, it will be still vulnerable. So I think as part of this briefing, we're going to release the tools that your AI used to demonstrate on how to create the fake certificate and how to do the man-in-the-middle attack on RDP. And I think to sum up, during this talk you've discovered a new vulnerability and also an interesting exploitation technique against Microsoft Windows networks. And at least for me, there are some lessons to be learned from that. You cannot blindly rely on patch management, because if you don't read the guidelines, sometimes Microsoft and other vendors, they choose to, you know, to maybe do an update, do a patch, but not necessarily block it from immediately blocking it from being exploited. The main reason is because they don't want to break any business from, you know, if suddenly an organization won't be able to RDP to its servers, that would be a major impact on the business. So it's important to read those things. I think for people that design cryptographic mechanisms, please don't sign untrusted data. It's not a good practice. And I think just as a last note, in Preempt, we believe in defense in depth, which means that you should have multiple layers of protecting or securing your network, things like monitoring account activity and things like that. This would be probably the best way to deal with things like that. I think that's it. It has been a pleasure. I think Eyal and Yaron can join us if you have any questions. Can come here. No.
Okay. So yes, what is needed for the attack to work is essentially a foot on the network. And once you have it, then on the same segment, if a client connects to a DC, you could do our poisoning or something like that, and that would enable you, without any credential, to take over the domain, actually. Yes, Yaron wants to address it, I guess, but...
Yes, so when we mentioned network segmentation, we actually meant stuff like firewalls. If you don't use RPC, then block RPC entirely. If only your IT administrators use RPC, then allow RPC from the IT network segments to other network segments. That way, if some user RDPs from another machine, not from the IT segment, then the vulnerability wouldn't be able to work. If the man in the middle is if someone blocks the man in the middle RPC payload, then you would win as the defender.
Thank you.